The Lord is coming, are you
Good evening, everyone. This is 287. I'm going to answer a question that I was asked, and it was in reference to the pre-tribulation, rapture, theory, whatever you want to call it. But the question I was asked was, why do we have it? So, basically what I'm being asked is, where did it come from? So, for all of you that are interested, I'm going to give you a quick history lesson. Now, remember one thing to keep in mind, way back when all these things were documented in books and manuscripts and so forth, people just documented information to keep record and pass on. It's not like today, people are writing books and all these things for profit and gain and all sorts of evil things that they can do to people by outing them for whatever reason. Back then, it was documentation. They documented everything by writing. They didn't have all the stuff we have today as far as technology. So keep that in mind. So when you start looking at books and manuscripts and all these things that are 200 and 300 and 400 years old and older, there is a lot of legitimacy for the most part for most of this information. So anyway, with that, let me go ahead and get right into this history lesson so some of you will have some better idea where this rapture theory came from. Now, during the time of Martin Luther in the 16th century, the 1500s, this was during the Reformation period. So there was a lot of things going on with the church then, the Roman Catholic Church, the Papal Church. They were the ones running everything. They were the ones who, by their own authority, say that they were the interpreters of the word. So their thing was to tell the people what the word meant, and the people weren't allowed to have scripture or read it, and most of them couldn't if they had it anyway. There was a lot of illiteracy and all sorts of things going on. But anyway, during this time, around about the time that Martin Luther put his 95 Theses on the church in Wittenberg, Pope Leo X, he authorized 3 Jesuit priests to reinterpret Daniel 10:24-27, 70-week prophecy, and the book of Revelation and Ezekiel. Now, the goal of the Jesuits were to take the pressure of the Reformation away from the papacy. So, the 3 Jesuit priests were Francisco Rivera, Luis de Alcazar, and Cardinal Roberto Bellarmine. Now, they were the forerunners of this theory. This is how it came about. Now, the futuristic rapture doctrine originated with Ribera in 1585. Now, his apocalyptic commentary was on the grand points of Babylon and Antichrist, and it's what we now call the rapture doctrine or the futurist doctrine. So, his published works was entitled In Sacrum Vitae Ionis, Apostoli and Evangelistic Apocalypsen Commentary. A lot of Latin in there. But anyway, this document was published in 1593, and it still exists at the Bodleian Library in Oxford, England. Now, this interpretation wreaked havoc not only to the Protestant church, but to the Catholic church. So what Pope Leo did was have them bury this information, where else, in the archives. It was buried, put out of sight. So what happened some 200 years later, there was a librarian by the name of Dr. S.R. Maitland, who was assigned or appointed keeper of those manuscripts at the Lambeth Palace in London, England. Now, in the course of his duties, he came across Francisco Ribera's futurist rapture teachings, and he had it republished for the sake of interest in 1826. And then he also did follow-ups in 1829 and 1830. Now, this was brought along with the Oxford Tracts that were published in 1833. Now, the goal of this was to protestantize the Church of England. So, now here comes a guy by the name of John Nelson Darby. Now, he was a leader of the Plymouth Brethren, and he became a follower of Dr. Maitland's prophetic endeavors, and he was convinced and persuaded reading all this doctrine. So now he's aligned with Maitland. Now, Darby had influence in the seminaries and in Europe, and he made several trips back and forth to the United States, and all these things combined changed the eschatological view of the ministers in the churches, and this had a trickle-down effect on the people in the churches. So now Darby and Rivera's teachings were embraced radically by another guy, Cyrus Ingerson Schofield. Hello, Schofield Bible. Here we go. This is where the Schofield Bible came from. Now, he adopted the theory and their school of prophetic thought into his Bible in 1909. So now you have the Schofield Bible, which refers to the rapture doctrine. So this is where it all started. Another individual who contributed to this line of thought was another Jesuit priest from Chile, and his name was Emmanuel Lacunza. Now, he published a work entitled Coming of the Messiah in Glory and Majesty, and attributed to a fictitious writer by the name of Rabbi Juan Yosefat Ezra. So now comes along Reverend Edward Irving, who contended that it was the work of a converted Jew and proved that even the Jewish scholars embraced the pre-tribulation line of thought. So it wasn't long before he persuaded others to follow this line of thinking. And so this gave birth to the Irvingites, and they're a group which is a member of the Catholic Apostolic Church. So now in 1830 in Port Glasgow, Scotland, there's a 15-year-old girl by the name of Margaret MacDonald. Now, she had a dream or a vision or what have you, and it made claims to the same type of thing, this rapture theory. And so this was published in a book called The Restoration of Apostles and Prophets in the Catholic Apostolic Church. And this was in London in 1861. So now this thing is really taking hold and everybody's starting to accept it. So now there are three things that came from this. Now, Lacunza, he concerted that only the those believers that partake in the sacrament of the Eucharist would be raptured. And Margaret MacDonald, the 15-year-old, she said that the rapture would only take those who were filled with the Holy Spirit. And Robert Norton, he claimed that only those who had been sealed with the Holy Ghost by the laying of the hands would be raptured. So now you have John Darby, who was an ordained deacon in the Church of England, and he was acquainted with Irving, and he had visited Margaret MacDonald during the time of revision. So combined with the knowledge he had gained from Dr. Maitland and Ribera's teachings and all these other people, this idea and this theory was pushed forward, because now you're dealing with people with influence and knowing other groups and all these things. So it spread. So it became common doctrine. It became common belief, common understanding. And that's where we are today. People have totally bought into it because it has been going on for so long. Now, one thing to take note of, before 1830, there was not one Christian church that proclaimed any type of rapture theory or doctrine. And in scripture, the 1 Thessalonians 4:13-18, those scriptures were accepted as what they are, resurrection. That was the closest thing to this rapture theory that there was, but it was understood and accepted as a resurrection. But now we call it, now we're referring to a rapture and pre-rapture and all these things. But, you know, that's just a little bit of history on how all it takes is for one lie to start rolling downhill and people start jumping on board and it takes hold. And then when you get people of influence involved, pushing these things forward, people actually start to believe it and buy into it. And this is why it is extremely important for you to study the Word on your own, do history lessons, dig up history, it's out there, and all these other things that you have questions about, because history and scripture go hand in hand. So that was a quick history lesson on the pre-rapture theory, doctrine, whatever you want to call it, and where it comes from, where it all originated. But that being said, remember, the Heavenly Father does not call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be faithful. This is Tube 87. I'm out.